Welcome to Oceanography, General Science, GS 108. I'm Gretchen Gebhardt, and I'm going to be your instructor this term. This week are going to talk about just a basic introduction to oceanography, and we'll be breaking this week's material down into three different videos. The first video will cover what oceanography is, how it works, why it's important, some of the main ideas in oceanography. Second video, we'll talk about a brief history of oceanography. And then the third video, we'll go into the geography of the world's oceans, as well as what's happening now in the Pacific Northwest. So, what is oceanography? Well, it's the scientific study of the world's oceans. So, looking at the structure, behavior, and history of the actual oceans themselves. This topic includes various sections such as marine geology, looking at the rocks, sediments, plate tectonics, physical oceanography, waves, currents, tides, chemical oceanography, looking at the salts and the gases that are present in the ocean water, and then looking at how climate and the oceans are connected to one another. And then, of course, we have life, marine biology, which we'll be talking about in the last few weeks of the term. So we're going to be getting into some of the basics of these five different sections of oceanography in this class. And here on the slide, you can see a picture demonstrating what the average salinity is of the world's oceans using data both from ship data as well as buoy data in the oceans. So when we get to salinity in a few weeks, you guys will see that figure again. So how does oceanography work? Well, we use the scientific method. Hopefully you're all familiar with what the scientific method is from other science classes you've taken. Now you're going to be doing this in class each week with discussion activities as well as lab activities. So you'll be making some observations of some material that I might be giving you, developing some questions regarding that material. Sometimes those questions are already provided for you. And then you're going to develop a hypothesis that will answer that question and go through and do some experiments in lab, looking at models, maybe looking at samples to see if that hypothesis is actually correct. And then you're going to reevaluate your hypothesis if you think it needs some tweaking, or you'll accept it and then communicate your findings. And you'll be communicating for your discussion activities online in the weekly forums, and we'll be talking in labs as well about some of the things that you're discovering in the lab activities. And then maybe you might need to reevaluate if you notice that, hey, my answer is not quite jiving with my neighbors. What's going on here? Discuss it and come up with a better idea. So in the scientific community, scientists do this. They publish their findings through presentations at different conferences as well as publishing documents in different scientific journals as well. So that's one of the methods that we use. What are the main ideas in oceanography? Well, one of the main things you have to look at is the Earth itself, looking at some of the things that are occurring on the Earth's surface. So yes, the Earth is constantly changing, different speeds, different rates. We have things changing very slowly, the rate that your fingernails might grow, or slower. And then we have things happening much faster, like earthquakes, volcanic eruptions, mass wasting, hurricanes. So things are constantly in a state of flux, both fast and slow. The Earth is also composed of some interacting parts, interacting spheres, as we call them. So we have the lithosphere, the rocks, plates of the Earth, the biosphere, the life that's present on the Earth, and the hydrosphere, which is the water, oceans, lakes, rivers, and then the atmosphere, what's happening up in the air in regards to climate, weather, clouds, things like that. And then when we look at matter and the Earth, we are closed in regards to matter. We don't lose chunks of the Earth to outer space. We might get a few meteorite impacts, but those are so small that they can be considered negligible. But we are open in regards to energy. You can see my drawing, not to scale, of the sun and the sun's rays striking the Earth. So we get a lot of energy from the sun, but we can also radiate that energy back out to space as well. So Earth closed in regards to matter, open in regards to energy. And then Earth is home to a diverse collection of life forms. So sea turtles, crustaceans, fish, corals, whales, mammals, and then some other organisms that are recently found in the center photo here at the bottom of the oceans at hydrothermal vents. So lots of different stuff living and interacting with one another on the planet. So why is oceanography important? Well, it's important for resource planning and acquisition, so fisheries, oil exploration and oil extraction, shipping lanes, traveling from one continent to another, land use planning in coastal areas, looking at coastal erosion, which we'll see a few slides, and also hazard mitigation on those slides as well, pollution and personal and social issues. So some coastal problems that we see is coastal erosion. These two photographs are on two different sides of the country, Walport, Oregon, and Jensen Beach, Florida. In Walport, Oregon, you see some houses up there on the top of this ridge here, and then a very steep cliff face, and then a nice flat beach in front. In the summertime, this is a pretty stable environment, but in the wintertime, when you get large storms rolling in off the coast, bigger storm surges, bigger waves, washing in, eroding the bottom of that cliff, making it more unstable, and causing some areas to collapse. So some of these houses look like they might be fine for now, but maybe in the next 10 to 20 years, they might be looking for another place to live. At Jensen Beach, Florida, we can see some coastal erosion here, much smaller erosional surface right in front of these dunes. This was caused by hurricanes that struck this part of the country a few years ago. And so both of these locations, people want to live on the coast. It's beautiful. Some of these hazards might not be happening on a yearly basis. It may be happening every 10 or 20 years. So people are going to live there. And the question is going to be, well, what are we going to do to make this a safer environment for them to live in? And some of the hazards like hurricanes that strike, we can see just some of the detrimental effects here on this barrier island. A barrier island is an island of sand, basically with some vegetation on it that protects the mainland from ocean dynamics, waves, storm surges, and such. So during hurricanes, waves get so big they actually can wash up and over these barrier islands, eroding material, taking out buildings, and actually in some cases, like you can see in this photograph here, in September of 2003, September 21st that is, the barrier island was actually breached by those waves. And then you can see the bottom two photographs, July 2001, September 2004, some of the damage that occurred due to these hurricane waves. So how do we live in these environments in a safer way? And then of course we've got trash in the oceans, pollution. We see large pieces of trash from fishing gear to just garbage that's been dumped in the oceans, washing up on beaches in Hawaii, Oregon, Japan, all of these different places. And this is a problem because a lot of these beaches are cleaned every year, come back, and it's just as covered in garbage as it was before. And we see large pieces of garbage like this, but we also have microscopic bits as well. And here you can see on the left the NOAA ships collecting data, collecting temperature, salinity, and samples of the ocean water. So taking and seeing what's living in that water, what's in that water living with those living organisms. And what we see in the picture on the right is plankton and plastic. And that plastic is just as small or smaller than the plankton. So anything that's going to be eating that plankton is going to be eating that plastic as well. So the question is, well, what's going to happen? What are the effects of this plastic in the ocean? Some other debris we can get in the oceans, there's a lot of it from the recent earthquake and tsunami in Japan. This is a model developed by NOAA, and what we see is the tracks of the debris as it moves through the oceans following the ocean currents. And we can see where they've predicted this debris to be with each year after that that event. So year one is red, year two is orange, year three is yellow, your five is blue, and then your five is purple. And we're right now in the orange-yellow scheme of things. So the question is going to be, well, how is this going to affect the oceans at this time? So what we've done now is kind of gone over some of the basics. And what I would like to do next is talk about the brief history of oceanography. So I'll sign off and see you in the next video.